We welcome you to worship today. And as we do so, we acknowledge that Calvary United Church stands on Treaty 6 territory. We pay our respects to our elders, both past and present, wherever we find ourselves this morning. We recommit to our status as an affirming ministry within the United Church of Canada and strive to be an open-minded, inclusive, and welcoming place of worship. It is our deepest hope that all people might feel at home in this space, and we give thanks to God for this Sabbath day, where we join our hearts and minds in prayer. This is the day that God has made, and we have reason to rejoice.
Friends and family gather together, sun shining, the arrival of spring.
Children laughing, old folks singing, the gift of time together.
Faith shared, trials endured, hope restored, all held sacred in His holy space.
This day that God has made, and we have reason to rejoice. God of grace and mercy, as we turn our hearts to worship, we pray that you might stretch our imaginations to understand you. Open us to the vastness of your presence. Allow us to see you in the world around us, hear you in the things that move us, find you in unexpected places. We admit it, God. There are times that faith is hard to hold on to. We read the scriptures, but find them more confusing than comforting. We bow our heads in prayer, but can't find the right words to say. We open our hearts to hear your voice, but are overwhelmed by silence. We turn our attention to good deeds, but are soon distracted by our own desires. Remind us that faith doesn't have to be perfect, unwavering, or doubt-free. Remind us to simply allow your Spirit to move in our lives and help us follow where you lead. We'll make our personal prayers of confession. It's amazing that God calls us to lay all our burdens, sins, and fears down, that we might make room for healing, mercy, and wholeness.
May we bear this forgiving love of God in such a way that it changes the world around us. Thanks be to God.
Mission. We all need someone who believes in us, someone who supports our dreams. Here is one story of how your belief and support make all the difference. In 2017, Arwa was a Palestinian refugee who had just arrived in Montreal. She had made a harrowing journey, traveling from Saudi Arabia through New York City with three children in tow. "It wasn't easy for me," she says. "I was a single mom in a new country with new people. I was struggling for housing and looking for a job. It wasn't easy at all." Aura sought help at Montreal City Mission, an outreach ministry, your mission and service gift support. There, the whole family found a place to belong. Aura's children made friends, and she benefited from training programs and events. It wasn't long before Arwa gathered a group of women together to form a catering cooperative called Women Weaving Their Dreams, which specialized in homemade Middle Eastern meals. The group was going strong, and the women were becoming more financially secure when COVID-19 struck. No stranger to hardship, Arwa was determined to help others through the pandemic. She initiated a sewing circle to make masks. In a relatively short period of time, the women of this sewing group made over 2,000 cloth masks for unhoused people and people of low incomes in their community. "I was so happy to help people," says Arwa, whose extraordinary leadership skills landed her a full-time job at Montreal City Mission. "I consider myself a lucky person that I got to know this organization. It has become not only my full-time job, but not only my provider. It has become my home. I hope to see more women getting the same chance to have a better life for their families," she said. "I wanted a country that could hold me and hug me my whole life long. I found it in Canada." Your mission and service gifts support people's dreams for a better life. Amazing people who make their communities and our country stronger.
Good morning and welcome to Children's Time. So for the last few weeks, we've been talking about Jesus. And then if you remember all the way back to last week, we were talking a little bit about Pentecost. Pentecost is coming up next week already. Somehow we are almost all the way through the season of Easter already. It feels like just yesterday it was Easter Sunday. So what I thought we would do, now that we've talked about who Jesus was to us and to the people in the Bible, Jesus was the Good Shepherd, and all of those things, and we talked about the Spirit last week and how the Spirit fills us if we keep Jesus' commandments, I thought that you and I could get a little bit more ready for Pentecost. So today, what we're going to do is we're going to build a Pentecost pinwheel. So if we remember what Pentecost is, when we think about Pentecost, there's the images of wind and of fire. So what we're going to do is we're going to build a pinwheel. You know what a pinwheel is. They spin in the wind. And we're going to decorate ours with fire. So what you're going to need is you're going to need a plain old piece of paper. You'll need some markers. I picked particularly fire-ish colors and a blue. I have a pipe cleaner that's going to act as our stem, but if you don't have a pipe cleaner at home, that's okay. You can use pretty much anything for a stem. I have some scissors, a hole punch, but again, if you don't have a hole punch at home, that's okay. I'm just using the hole punch so that I can put the pipe cleaner through my pinwheel. And then I have some tape. You could also use glue or whatever you have at home. Some people use like brad staplers for paper to make pinwheels, and then they stay really well, but we don't have those. So I'm just going to use this, what I have. So the first thing you're going to want to do is you're going to want to take your paper. I'm using a little bit of cardstock so it stays together easily, and you're going to make a square. So we're going to make a square by folding it like this. So there's a long edge here, and we're going to cut this piece off. All right, that leaves you with a square. And I have a nice crease in the middle here, if you can see, folds easily that way. We're gonna do the same thing on the opposite corner. So we're gonna take these corners and fold them like this so that we have a nice crease going this way as well. So you wanna go right corner to corner. Make sure that everything lines up, because it'll be straightest if you do it that way. And then, just like when we're doing origami, we're gonna want to make sure that the corners and the creases are nice and tight. So you're gonna push down on them with your thumb, or if you need to, you can use one of your markers or anything to get that crease there. Okay, and then we're gonna open it back up. So we have two creases, one on either side. You can fold this way or this way. And to make our pinwheel, what we do is we cut down just over halfway on each of the creases. That. I went a little off script on this one. I went a little sideways. We'll see how it goes. That's the nice thing about art, is you can't really do it wrong. So the next thing that we're gonna do is we're gonna take one corner and fold it from the outside all the way right to the middle. So it'll sit like this. And like I said, you can use glue, or I'm going to use tape to tape it down. And then we're gonna go to the same corner on the next piece. So we don't wanna fold in this corner, which is on the same side. We wanna go to the next side and fold it into the middle. So once I get that one taped down, I will show you. So this is what it'll start to look like. We're only folding in one corner of each side. We're not folding in both, so you end up with a little piece sticking out on the sides. And then we'll go to the next one and do the same again. And the same thing on the next side. All four sides need to be like this. So you're gonna end up with a pinwheel shape, and then I'm gonna flip it over so that it's here, hopefully that. And then we're gonna decorate the inside. So I'm gonna write some nice words that are things that kind of go along with Pentecost inside. I'm gonna write love, I'm going to write spirit, I'm going to write hope, and what's more, one more word, let's write God. All right, so I just put those there so they'll spin around and we can see them all as they're spinning. And the next thing I'm going to do is I'm going to decorate the bottom with all of our flame colors, so that it looks like there's flames going in our circle. And this part is very free form. You don't have to make it look like an actual flame. I'm just gonna kind of draw little squiggly marks on it. just gives us the idea of fire. And then when you make your pinwheel at home, you will be all ready for Pentecost. If you come and worship with us next Sunday in person, we are going to be having guests here. It's the regional annual meetings next weekend. So we'll have lots of guests here, and then you can bring your pinwheel and celebrate Pentecost with us. Or if you're online, we will do something Pentecost-y online as well. All right, so I'm just going to finish decorating with a little bit of highlighter yellow. And these can look like however you want. I've seen people that drew doves all over theirs. They drew tongues of flame. That's kind of what I'm going for. People that drew actual fire on there. If you really want to go the simple route and you have a printer at home, there's lots of these that you can just print out from templates online. If you need a little more tape, you can go ahead and add it, so that everything stays nice and snug. So this is what it's going to end up looking like after it's all decorated. And the next thing we're going to do is I'm going to take my hole puncher and somehow try and sneak it into the middle. I might need to use my scissors instead of a hole puncher because I don't think this is going to fit. And I'm just going to punch a hole very carefully with adult help if you're a little person, instead of using scissors by yourself. And I'm going to punch a hole through the middle. Nope, just about through. Go to the back, make sure it's all the way through on this side too. Hopefully I don't hurt myself. Like I said, we should be using a hole puncher. All right, and now what we're gonna do is we're gonna take our pipe cleaner and we're gonna tape it onto the back. So it's a little stem. And if you manage to get yours through the middle, or you have a hole puncher that works a little bit better than mine, then you can put it all the way through and make a little ball with it so it doesn't go in. And there we go. There's our little pinwheel for Pentecost. All right, so like I said, you're encouraged to bring them to church with you. You can have them with you when we worship online next week, when we'll be all ready for receiving the Spirit, the gift of the Spirit that lives within each of us through the fire and the wind. We'll be ready for it. All right, have a great week. Bye-bye. Thank you.
In the first book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day when he was taken up to heaven, after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles whom he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself alive to them by many convincing proofs, appearing to them during 40 days and speaking about the kingdom of God. While staying with them, he ordered them not to leave Jerusalem, but to wait there for the promise of the Father. This, he said, is what you have heard from me. For John baptized with water, but you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. So when they had come together, they asked him, Lord, is this the time when you will restore the kingdom to Israel? He replied, it is not for you to know the times or the periods that the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be witnesses in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, and to the ends of the earth. When he had said this, as they were watching, he was lifted up, and a cloud took him out of their sight. While he was going, and they were gazing up toward heaven, suddenly two men in white robes stood by them. They said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand looking up toward heaven? This Jesus, who has been taken up from you into heaven, will come in the same way as you saw him go into heaven. The next reading is from John 17, 1 to 11. After Jesus had spoken these words, he looked up to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you, since you have given him authority over all people, to give eternal life to all whom you have given him. And this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I glorified you on earth by finishing the work that you gave me to do. So now, Father, glorify me in your own presence with the glory that I had in your presence before the world existed. I have made your name known to those whom you gave me from the world. They were yours, and you gave them to me, and they have kept your word. Now they know that everything you have given me is from you, for the words that you gave to me, I have given to them, and they have received them and know in truth that I came from you, and they believe that you sent me. I am asking on their behalf. I'm not asking on behalf of the world, but on behalf of those whom you gave me, because they are yours. All mine are yours, and yours are mine, and I have been glorified in them. And now I am no longer in the world, but they are in the world, and I am coming to you. Holy Father, protect them in your name that you have given me, so that they may be one as we are one. Hear what the scriptures are saying to the church.
May the words of my mouth and the meditation of each and every heart be acceptable unto you, O God, our Creator and Redeemer. Amen. Well, my friends, I don't know about you, but that reading from the 17th chapter of John's Gospel this morning that was done so beautifully for us, Gail, thank you. How do I put this? It is really, deeply, truly, and undeniably confusing. I read it a couple of weeks ago and thought, Then I read it at the beginning of this week and thought, nah. And then I read it on Wednesday afternoon and I thought, okay. Thursday and Friday, I decided to just ignore it. By the time Saturday rolled around, I knew I had to do something. Sunday was coming. So I visited with the ladies in the kitchen. It was enjoyable and inspirational, that time in the kitchen, and lucrative because they fed me. But as I wandered back to my office, I thought if egg salad sandwiches made a good preacher, well, there'd be more good preachers. As I watched some of your faces this morning while the passage was read, I wish to assure you that I did look at the other passages to see if they were any better. They weren't. And so I reluctantly returned to John on Saturday afternoon, his 300 references to glory. Okay, to be fair, there's only six, but still, that's a lot for 10 verses. And this rather baffling ending to Jesus' famous farewell discourse. You may recall that last week I preached about how the Bible, in all its deep and divinely inspired wisdom, is in truth just a book, meant to point us to the Holy One, rather than to be held up as something holy in and of itself. So I did ponder the possibility of going completely off the rails and preaching on something else altogether. But then I remembered how my Old Testament prof, the fellow from last week who jumped on the Bible, you'll recall, caused all the Anglicans to freak out. Sorry for Anglicans in the room. But he also told us that while this book has human fingerprints all over it, we must keep our hearts and minds open when we read it. It's also what we've got. These words have survived thousands of years, and so it would be foolish of us to just toss it aside without thought or effort. There is a lot for us to learn here, and sometimes the passages that offer the most confusion are indeed the ones that eventually offer the most insight. Naturally, I do not promise that you'll be offered any great insight today. But if you are willing, let's dive into John 17 and see what we find. As I mentioned, this chapter comes near the end of Jesus' life and wraps up what is known as the farewell discourse. This part of the biblical narrative follows a scene we are all very familiar with, where Jesus shares the Last Supper, washes the disciples' feet, and offers that amazing new commandment, love one another as I have loved you. Perfect. He promises them that the Holy Spirit will come to them as advocate and guide. He tells them how he is the vine and they are the branches, always connected to each other. And he assures them that even though he won't be with them much longer, they will never be alone. But there comes a point when Jesus stops teaching and he starts to pray. In the other three Gospels, you'll recall how Jesus goes to the garden to pray. He asks the disciples to stay awake, they promptly fall asleep, and in his prayers, Jesus asks for the cup to pass him by, barring that option, that he might have the courage to accept whatever is coming. In John's Gospel, however, Jesus prays not in a garden, but at the supper table. Everyone is there. They are far from asleep. Rather, they hang on his every word. And while it is confusing and repetitive and a bit much, I can't help but think of how powerful a moment this would have been. Them hearing Jesus pray for them. It is funny how things tend to happen or work out. But in the last 10 days, I've had, eight people come and ask me about prayer. How it works, why I do it, how I do it, what's the point in doing it when so many prayers seem to go unheeded, and perhaps most poignantly, how do we know that God's actually listening when God is so piercingly quiet so much of the time? Thomas Merton spoke of prayer as a compass. I like that idea. That prayer helps us to know where we are when we're all turned around, maybe points us in a new direction. David Fleming is one of many who has said that prayer is a conversation. I like that too, and I suppose it means we have to leave some room for silence, even when it's annoying to do so. Kathleen Norris wrote of a Benedictine friend who said, "Often all I can do is ask God, Lord, what is it you want of me?" She continues, "From him, I have learned that prayer is not asking for what you think you want, but asking to be changed in ways that you can't imagine." And then there's that moment, that vulnerable moment that comes to most of us eventually, when we allow ourselves, often reluctantly, to be prayed for. One of the first times I heard someone genuinely pray for me was Donna Christofferson. It was 21 years ago. She didn't really know me, but she knew I had a really hard service to lead that morning. More than that, it was my first hard one. And she just showed up, knocked on the door of the manse, handed me a flower, and asked if she could pray for me. Of course, I said, yeah, that'd be great. And then she pushed her way into the house and got down on her knees. And I went, oh, you mean like for real right now? And I joined her. I cannot remember what I had for supper last night. I do remember every word of the prayer she lifted for me that day. I remember the courage and strength it offered me to face that moment. And I know I will never forget it. So I suppose today all I can offer is the same thing that I've offered others these past few days as we reflect on the prayer that Jesus lifted for his disciples. I am not sure how prayer works, but then I don't know how my car turns on either when I press the button. I do not know why some prayers seem to go unheard, or why God has the bad habit of answering in ways that aren't as straightforward as we would like. But I do know that a prayer that was lifted for me 21 years ago still offers me courage when I face hard days now. I know that when I turn my heart and mind to the Holy One, either in grief or in gratitude, I feel less alone. I know that when I can't find the words to say to God, and so I do nothing but sigh or cry or roll my eyes, the words, "Be still and know that I am God," wash over me, and I grasp a moment, even if it's fleeting, a moment of peace. And I have a feeling that when the disciples thought back to that day when Jesus prayed for them, it brought them the comfort and the courage they needed to in turn pray for those who would follow them. In his life, Jesus did a lot of things, but perhaps his most significant miracle of all was offering you and I a relationship with God, one that was different than what had been taught before he came, one that transcends time and space, one that invites us to open ourselves to mystery, one that allows us to be really, truly, undeniably honest with our God, that we can say whatever it is we need to say. Would you pray with me now? God of all things, seen and unseen, creator and life giver, had you insulated yourself from the pain of the world, if you had remained distant and obscure, then your name could not be love and our condition would be without hope. And so gathered here, we, your people, thank you for being with us, for revealing your complete commitment to us through Jesus of Nazareth. In him we pray this morning with unending hope. In him we pray this morning with abundant love. God, let your healing love be known this day by all who suffer illness of body, or distress of mind, or agony of spirit. We pray for those who are waiting for results. We pray for those who are enduring treatments. We pray for those who are recovering from surgery. We pray, God, for Nestor Hirchuk, for Margaret McLeod. We pray for Blaine and Irene Bredner. We pray for Mark Giriak. We pray for Lucas Beckler. Shower upon us your compassion and bring healing. God of life, let your familiar love be known today by all who feel lost or forgotten, and all who are walking in the dark valley of despair and sorrow. God, we pray for the family and friends of Lulintic. Shower upon us your compassion and bring comfort. God, let your fierce love this day undo the wrongs of all who suffer exploitation, injustice, abuse, neglect, violence, or hatred. We pray for those around the world who endure war, who live in fear of their governments. Shower upon us your compassion and bring peace to this world. God of life, let your nurturing love encourage those who are looking for guidance as they make tough decisions, take on new responsibilities, or break free from situations that are unhealthy and unsafe. Shower upon us your compassion and offer wisdom. God of life, let your courageous love move upon us this day. We pray, God, for all our first responders. We pray for our paramedics and our police and everyone who walks into situations, responds to situations when life is on the line. We pray for our healthcare workers, everyone who gives more than they have to make our lives better and safer. Shower upon us your compassion, God of life, and offer courage. God, let your relentless love this day set this, your congregation, on fire, that we might reach out to our community with loving, open, and faith-filled arms. Fill this place with your power and your spirit and your purpose. Shower upon us your compassion and remind us to pray with our hands and our feet. Let your reconciling love gather our city together, bring healing and balance and friendship. Help us use your presence in the diversity that exists here, and help us listen to the ways those who might seem different than us find you, talk to you, are moved by you. Shower upon us your compassion and bind us to one another. Let your inspiring love this day rejuvenate all of us, God of life. Help us speak to you in ways that are familiar and honest. Empower us to ask for what our hearts long for. Help us truly and deeply know what it is that you long for us. And so we pause now in a moment of silence that we might offer to you what each one of us carries. All this and so much more we lift to you, sometimes confident that you hear and sometimes a little unsure, and yet finding strength in those around us. We say to you the words you taught us through Jesus the Christ, calling you by whichever name feels most like home, we say. Okay, real quick story. You know Luke, he's taller than me now. He wasn't always, which I have to remind him. You used to be shorter than me. And one summer, our first summer at the lake, we were up camping. I'm a Holiday Inn kind of girl. So this camping thing, very new to me. So we're at the lake. Derek, of course, sets us all up and promptly leaves, goes back to the city. And I was there with the kids. My sister was with us. And Grace and I woke up early, and I thought, you know what? We'll just zip into town site, get cinnamon buns, famous Waskasoo cinnamon buns, and we'll head out back out to our campsite, which is about a 20-minute drive. No problem. Go in, get the buns, come back. I'm thinking I'm being the best auntie in the world. I'm going to walk in with these amazing cinnamons, buns. I walk in. Everyone's still asleep. I'm like, oh, perfect. And then I look, and there's no Luke. Now, he was about 4 years old, and I thought, odd. I go out. His bike and helmet are gone. So then I wake everybody up, and he had to crawl on top of my sister and my nephew to get out of the camper, okay? This was like a stealth escape this child made. And now he's God knows where. Of course, I instantly assume he's in the lake. So I start running around frantic, and my daughter, who at the time was six, says, how about we look for him? Good idea, six-year-old, let's do that. So she heads one way, I head the other, and we're going around. It's about 8 o'clock in the morning. We're waking the entire campsite out, calling for this child's name. No Luke, nowhere to be found. This man comes out of his tent, and he's like, do you lose somebody? I'm like, yeah, my son, have you seen him? He's like, no, but I will pray. And I turned and looked at him. I said, dude, put your prayers into action and help me look. When we finally did find Luke, he, of course, knew exactly where he was. He didn't know where I was. So when he found me, he ripped up one side of me and down the other about how you always have to leave a note and you can't just take off on someone and this isn't how we act in this family. He was very angry. Anyway, point is, we can pray for a lot of stuff. And you know I'm on this honesty, authentic, tell God whatever it is you need to tell God kick right now, and we're going to hold on to that for a while because I'm deeply immersed in this honesty thing right now. It's going to get tiresome. I apologize, Ed. But say whatever it is you need to say to God. And that includes anger, swearing, whatever. God can take all of it. And then we need to also figure out how we act those prayers out. Because it is not enough to just say, God, feed the hungry people, and assume someone else is going to do it. It is not enough to say, God, heal my relationship, and then not do anything about it. God is not a magic fairy that will wave a wand and suddenly fix everything. God needs you and I to do that. And I think that's really why Jesus prayed for those disciples after he went on and on in that discourse for like, it was a lot, it was not quite as bad as the Sermon on the Mount that went on forever. But it went on for a long time, that discourse. And I'm sure they were starting to glaze over and the Manischewitz was looking real good. And then finally, he had to say, they need more courage if they're going to do this. They need to know that they're not alone. And so Jesus prays for them to be able to live out their mission, to live out their prayers in the world. And same thing goes for us. So don't ever hold back. Don't ever feel guilty about what you offer to God. Don't ever feel that you don't have the words, because you do. And even when you don't, we are told the Spirit will intercede for us. So don't ever worry about that kind of stuff. I don't know how to talk to God. Don't. Just give it. Lay it out. And then look around and see how you can live that out. And we will all be at Gail's house next week to help her pack. As people of faith, we have gathered for worship.
As people of faith, we now turn to the world beyond the
city. May we go out to share this story we have, a story of faith that binds us to each other.
A story of faith that gives life and hope to do through your prayers to
And all God's people said?
Amen.